Today I'm going to teach you how to make your first budget. Hi everyone, welcome back to the Ready Set Life YouTube channel. As always, my name is Brittany and I am a financial coach who makes videos all about taking the fear out of finance so that you can live the rest of your life. Make sure to subscribe if you haven't, and if you like this video, make sure to share it with a friend so that they can get something awesome out of it also. So today I'm going to teach you how to make your first budget. That's right, if you've never made a budget before, or if you've tried to make a budget and you hated the entire experience, I know, I feel you. I'm going to teach you how to not hate your life and make an easy to understand, totally badass plan for your money that you can stick to. This is exactly what I teach my one-on-one clients, and it is the first step to taking control of your finances. So let's get right into it. The first thing that I always tell my clients is to get comfy. You're going to want to be sitting down in your favorite pair of sweats with your favorite drink, a nice warm hot chocolate maybe, or a glass of wine, whatever makes you the happiest. We want to make sure that it is an enjoyable experience. We're going to be looking at numbers for a while, and that's going to suck. So we want to make sure that our environment is the best that it can be to help us focus and get things that we need to done. And the second thing that you're gonna do is pause this video. That's right, pause this video and go and download my budget template. The next part of this video is all about the nitty-gritty details of how to actually make the budget, so it's best that you can follow along while I'm talking. So click the link down below to get access to the Google Sheet that I'll be showing you in this video. All right, you good? You got it? Okay, let's jump right into the numbers. So here is my budget template. I know that budgets can be super boring to look at, so I tried to kind of make this one a little bit more colorful and nicer to look at. Hopefully you're getting that vibe from that, but feel free to make it whatever colors kind of speak to you and what you want. I also practice what I preach. So this is my amaretto. It's got a little bit of lime in it, and I love it. This is my favorite drink, and I am also in yoga pants. We'll make the experience enjoyable for the both of us. So the first thing that you're going to see is this income spot here. Now most of you are going to be on regular income, and that means basically that you get consistent income throughout a regular basis. So whether that's monthly or weekly or bi-weekly or anything like that, there's a special way to kind of deal with irregular payments. So if you are that person, if you like work for yourself or you just don't really know month to month what money is going to come in, try and put an average here, and then let me know in the comments down below if you're in this zone, and maybe I'll make a video kind of explaining that process a little bit better if that's needed. But again, most of you will be on regular income, so we'll stick with that for now with the easy part. And we'll kind of use that as an example. And this is where you'll put your after-tax income. So when you look at your paycheck, there's going to be a lot of different numbers on there. They should be taking some tax off. And there should be kind of like a gross pay amount, taxes before your salary before taxes, as well as your after-tax amount. And that's the amount that you want. So you want the amount that's actually going into your account every month to put in here. I'm going to kind of also give you my numbers of when, like a couple years ago when I started this out, so that you can kind of see like a real scenario instead of me just explaining a blank template. I think it's going to be a lot easier for you to actually see like real numbers in here. So I'm going to kind of go back and forth from my old budget and put in the numbers here that make sense for that. So in that position, I was getting paid bi-weekly, and I was getting paid two paychecks of that. So I'm just going to copy it to the next spot here. Now, if you get paid weekly, for example, and you need to add another line to this, the way that you do that is select the whole row and then right click and scroll all the way down. I'm going to move this so that you can see. Right click, scroll, and say insert above. And you always want to insert above, especially this total income row. So there's a lot of calculating going on in some of this Excel. So in order to not mess up those calculations, make sure that you're inserting your rows above the total lines that are in here. So there's kind of through sections, and from each of these blue lines, make sure that if you're adding anything, which you can totally do that, and you probably need to do that for some things, make sure that you add stuff above it so that you're not playing around with those calculations that are in there. So once we've put in our income, it is time to work on our expenses. So that is kind of the next thing. If you start scrolling down, you can see that there are a bunch of expense like examples of expenses, and they're all kind of sectioned out into different categories of expenses, and that just really helps to keep things organized. So in the housing expenses spot, you will probably not use all of these. It's going to be very different of whether you rent or whether you own your own home. So if you rent, for example, you're not going to have property taxes or like a homeowners association or anything like that. So those lines won't apply to you. But if you have a mortgage, then all of those lines are going to be important. So just keep in mind that this is all kind of inspiration and an idea of what your expenses could be, but you don't need to fill all of these in, and some of them actually probably won't apply to you at all. So that's totally fine to just take out those lines. So another thing that I wanted to explain was these two kind of sections here. So as you're going through and filling in the things that make sense to you all the way down, there's this things to consider spot. So if you ever get stuck in kind of a situation where you're not really sure what to do, try looking at this things to consider section, because there's helpful tips in there about how to actually fill this out. So for example, the home repairs and maintenance section, that can be really hard to actually estimate, especially if like maybe it's your first year owning your home or something like that, and you have no idea how much you're going to spend on that. Try and estimate like for the year how much you're going to spend. And if you don't really know, like if it's your first year owning a home or something, then just like Google the average like home repairs for a year kind of thing, and just kind of use that number, and then just divide it by 12, so it's like divided by the year. And then in the notes here is where I like, well, you could leave whatever notes that you want to, but I like to kind of give reasoning why I put certain things there. So for example, down here, I have $200 a month for groceries, but it's based on a $400 a month, like family cost. So for example, like me and my partner, Alex, we spend $400 a month on groceries, and each of us pays half of that because we split expenses. So $200 is mine and $200 is his. So I just want to like keep that in there as a frame of mind. So that I ever kind of go back and look on this and I'm like, ah, $200, like I spend a lot more than groceries, or I spend a lot more than $200 on groceries per month, that's kind of confusing why I put that there, then I can look at that note section and say, oh yes, I remember, that's why I did that. And the same thing goes all the way down for all of these other expenses here, especially when you get into like gifts and things like that. The gifts is often a little bit hard to guesstimate as well, but you kind of have to total up maybe by the people that you have in your life. So for example, I have 3 different family members, and then my partner, Alex, and those are the people that I usually buy gifts for. So I've kind of calculated like $40 for each birthday of each family member, and then $100 for Alex for his birthday, and each family member again for Christmas, because we usually do like Christmas gifts and then birthday gifts. And then I've calculated that out and divided it all by 12 to make $36 per month. So it can be a little bit like confusing, and you'll have to like play around with it a tiny bit. But again, these like hints and things to consider will help you out a lot. And then just remember to kind of break everything down into a monthly cost. So even if you like pay for it yearly, put it into a monthly cost so that you're actually remembering that those things exist and you're not like surprised by the fact that it comes up every year. Okay, so when you're all done, you can be able to scroll all the way down to the bottom, and you'll see your total expenses for the month there, and then there's also going to be a line that says, is there anything left? And this is the important number. It's an exciting number, because this means that you have extra money to put towards your goals. Now, if it's a negative number, don't worry, don't freak out about it. A lot of people start off with a negative number, and that's okay. If it's negative, that just means that you have to kind of go through your expenses here and kind of try and figure it out to make it work. So for example, if this was negative by like $300, I might say, okay, well, let's see what I can cut here. So I can like bring my eating out and lunches down to cut that right in half. So it'll be like 110, I guess, instead of 120. And then that changes that number and it gives it a positive number there. So just kind of, if it's a negative number, don't freak out. Go all the way back to the start and kind of start looking line by line what kind of things that you can move around and what you can kind of stretch in your budget to make those numbers work. Because that's probably why you're feeling so stressed,
is because you're actually overspending by that amount every month. And that's okay. A lot of people are in that situation, but it's just kind of taking that realization is a little bit of a shock sometimes. A lot of people are in your situation, and it's an easy thing to fix. If you go through and you can't find anything to cut or like change or anything like that, that's also okay. It just means that you have to look at the income side of things, which sometimes can be harder to work with, but it's totally manageable. So you can start a side hustle, or you can start looking at like new job opportunities or a raise in your current position or things like that, to kind of help you out in that respect. So after that, you will get your number, your kind of positive number if you have one. And what I like to do with this is I like to actually give this number a job. So if I see that there's actually money left over, then I'm going to want to take that number, so 1452.25, and I'm going to say my financial goal is to build up a fund so that I can coach full time instead of like working at my current job. So in order to do that, I'm going to add in, I'm going to go up to the savings line, and I'm going to insert a row above the total savings line row, and I'm going to say save for coaching. And there's a G on the end of that. And then I'm going to put in 1452.25, which was all the rest of that. And then it's going to make that number zero. So that way, then I know I'm going to put this amount every month into the coaching fund, basically. And I'm going to have a bank account that's named coaching fund, and I'm going to put that amount in there every month, and it's going to build up. Now, if you have that much left over, you can totally like beef up other things too. Like, I don't know if you would want to put $1,400 in a specific, that one spot. You could like add it to your RSP payment. You can put them honestly to whatever you want. You want to save for a vacation, anything. And it doesn't just have to be one thing. You can kind of add it to three or four things if you want to, especially if you have that large of a number, which not often happens. I want to say that. I know that like before, in the days when I was paying off debt, that number was pretty tight. But in the days when I was kind of like a couple years ago when I was now debt free, then this number was a lot larger because I didn't have any debts to pay off. And that's kind of the budget that I'm using. So I want to say it's not unrealistic to have that much left. Some people do actually have that much left. But don't be upset if you don't have this much left. It's not.
All right. So I already know that this video is going to be so long. So I'm going to cut it up into two different parts. So this first part, you're going to have your budget foundation done. That's just what I showed you. And in the second part, I'm going to teach you how to actually use the budget on kind of a paycheck to paycheck scenario and kind of put all the numbers into use in your everyday life. It's definitely one thing to have these numbers, but it's another thing to actually implement them into your day-to-day life. So make sure you tune in next Thursday because I'll be putting up part two of this budget tutorial. So until next time, make sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel, click the little notification bell so you don't miss any of my new videos. And let me know down below, were you negative or positive in your ending numbers? And what goal are you working towards with your leftover money? All right, thanks for watching everyone. Bye.